Hi, we've been talking about the way what we are still affected by popularity and why popularity is so important. And previously we talked about the ways that it might really be built into how our brains are set up and even how our DNA responds and is expressed. But I wanted to move on by talking a little bit about how popularity is affecting each and every one of us, actually, thousands of times a day. Especially, we are going to talk about how your experience with popularity when you were younger affect a lot of the ways that we think about our social experiences. But before we do that, I'd like to for you to watch this video. Just watch the video and you're going to be asked to say a little bit about that you saw in the video. So watch carefully. So what we are going to talk about now has been studied by a psychologist for many years, and it's referring to as social information processing. Nikki Creek and Ken Dodge were among the first to develop a model. It's really a way to talk in every single social experience you have and to zoom in it down into a spare slow mode. So if you were to try and think about all of the tiny little unconscious processes that are happening between the moment that you see something and the moment that you respond, you would divide them up into a few different steps. So the first thing that happens is that there's an event. This could be a big event, like someone breaks up with you, or it could be a tiny little event, like you're walking through a crowd and someone nods at you. Very subtle. It turns out that in order for us to respond to that event, there are many little steps that happen. And the first one is whether or not we encode that event. So for instance, if you were walking through a crowd and someone nodded at you, you might not even notice it. You might be looking at somebody else, or you might be looking at your phone answering emails, or you might be assuming that no one is interested in looking at you. So you don't really even attend to that happens. It's very common for professionals to talk about teaching in their class, and rather than noticing in all of the students that are looking at them and kind of nodding, they really tend to focus on just those students that are looking down and clearly are doing Facebook while they are lecturing. And that's a really great example of QN coding. The idea that they tend to even just notice something more than others and actually don't even see them or other things in their visual field at all. Well, once we see something, once we encoded something and we have said that our brain has been it to something to us, when we have to interpret it, that it is that we are seen or heard or felt, and we can that cue interpretation, and there are many different ways that we might interpret it. That it is that we just encoded, and we will talk about that more in just a second. Well, after we are interrupted something, when again really fast, unconsciously, we don't even realize that we are doing it. We even decided that is our goal. What are we hoping to have in this particular situation, and what becomes and what becomes an important step called goal clarification. Once we have a goal, we come up with a variety of possible things that we could to do respond. We select one of those response again, super fast. We are not even aware we are doing it, and when we follow through on that with response and attainment. So in other words, we decided to act out what it is that we say that we thought, rather what we wanted to do. And once we'd respond, that often produce a new event. So for instance, if this all started by someone nodding at you and you end up deciding to nod back, that might lead to them waving or saying hi or something like that. If you decided instead to do something rude to them, when that might lead to some sort of event, there it would start a whole new cycle. And it happens again and again. Well, all of this happens based on all of your prior experiences. So every single experience that we've had socially is stored in a database. And this is actually good brain research to say that when we look at how people respond to things, it often is involving centers of our brain involved in autobiographical memory. So we are very frequently drawing upon these old experiences, particularly as it turns out, experiences with popularity as a way to understand how very social experience happens to us every single day today. And sometimes we think about these steps very, very explicitly. We'll talk about that in a second, but first let's talk about an example where we might see this play out, and I am going to show you three different pretend people and how we might respond to a similar event. So for instance, imagine that someone walks by, they look at you, they smile and they judge a little bit. Well, imagine that in the QA content step, the first person might look at that and say, I just saw a person laughing at me. Okay, so they, because of their database, they really attended to the laughing. The second person might say, I just saw a person make eye contact and smile. So they don't really remember the laughing as much. Their studies show that if you asked them later, they might not even resell that that happened, or they might not even noticed it, but they are really noticing their eye contact and the smile. And the third person, maybe the kind of person that doesn't believe that anyone would ever smile at them. They have a limited time, lifetime of rejection or feeling that they are never noticed by anybody. They are studies show less likely to even notice when people do look at them. So they might not even notice anybody. Well, the next step that would happen then is cue interpretation. So that first person might say, I think that person was making fun of me. I saw them kind of laughing, and my automatic thoughts, the thing I immediately associate with that is, I think they were tasting me somehow. But maybe the second person who kind of was really noticing the eye contact and the smile might interpret that by saying, oh, I think maybe that person's flirting with me. And of course, the third person who don't even see anybody would probably say, what person? I don't even know what you're talking about. So that's the end of them. The next step would be goal clarification. So if you believe that someone has just tasted you, that first person might say, well, in this situation I want to assert my dominance. I really want to make sure that people don't taste me.